I We are, surprise, surprise, learning a new hymn this morning. Although most of you have been at the Bible study this morning, the hymn study we've had, so you should know the tune. Anyway, it's number 305 in the green hymnal, Jesus Paid It All. And there is a refrain to the end of each verse. So 305 in the green hymnal. We'll go over the first and the last verses. First verse and the last verse.
Okay.
Beautiful tune. We will be singing that during communion. So thank you for going over it with us this morning. Again, we have come to worship, but before that, let us be still and just breathe in
God's love and let us come and worship. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Please be seated. We're reading what's called the Decalogue or the Ten Commandments, and as Kathleen said to me this morning, do we really have to hear these twice? Because our first reading this morning is the Ten Commandments. And yes, we are going to hear them twice. When you hear it repeated twice, maybe it has something to say. Hear the commandments of God to his people. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of bondage. You shall have no other gods but me.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not make for yourself any idol.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Honor your father and your mother.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit murder.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit adultery.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not steal.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not be a false witness.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. And we pray together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. The collect, which is really a collection of our thoughts in prayer. The collect of the third Sunday in Lent. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. The readings from Scripture.
First reading is from the book of Exodus, again. God spoke all these words to Moses on Mount Sinai. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other idols before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 19, and we'll read it, the organ side and then the non-organ side. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world. In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent.
Good job. The second reading is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So for our sequence hymn, take out your phones and type in Psalm 119, verse 11, NIV, the New International Version. Psalm 119, verse 11, it's on your phones. And we'll sing it through twice and then once more after the reading of the gospel. Okay, give you a moment to get it. Psalm 119, verse 11. Says,
I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Psalm 119, verse 11 says, "I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. That I might not sin against you. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. There are a few teachers, former teachers in the room, so this will be an interesting story for you. I came across this from a book written by Bishop Tom Wright, who was a bishop in the Church of England. And he tells this story. Imagine the scene in school. The students are all taking their end of year exams. The teachers are preparing for a big open day when parents and friends will come to visit. Everyone is excited. It's the biggest moment of the school year. Suddenly, the door of the head teacher's office bursts open. In walks a student with a few friends behind him. He goes straight to the desk where the secretary is organizing a pile of examination scripts, and he turns the desk upside down, scattering the scripts all over the room. He proceeds into the head teacher's private room, where with a single sweep of his arm, he knocks to the floor all the letters and papers and invitations and arrangements so carefully made for the big day that's coming up. He turns to the astonished onlookers and says, "This whole place is a disgrace. It's corrupt from top to bottom. You ought to be ashamed of yourselves." Before he can get away, the head teacher himself arrives. "What right have you got to behave like this?" he asks. "You can feel me, if you like," replies the student. "You can throw me out. But I shall go to university. I'm going to train as a lawyer, and one day I'll put an end to corruption like this. Your system is finished. And before they can stop him, he leaves. Why did the student get angry? What corruption was there in that system? The student saw injustice, and injustice cried out to him, and he had to act. He turned over the tables. I dread to think what would happen to a student, either here or in England, if that was to happen. But it gives an illustration of what Jesus did that day coming up to the Passover. Jesus was in Jerusalem, and the celebration of the Passover was coming up. The Passover was a celebration of liberation. Liberation from Egypt, where God had led his people from bondage in Egypt, and they had to sacrifice a lamb, and the blood of that lamb was to be put on their doorposts, and when the angel of death passed over, they were saved. That's why it's called the Passover, because the angel passed over. So this was a wonderful festival. Jesus went into the temple. The temple was the heartbeat of the Jewish people, the heartbeat of Judaism. There was the cultural, political headquarters of God's people. In the temple was God's presence. And all around them would have been animals, because the sacrificial system that they had for the atonement of sin happened there. There were sacrifices every day. Jews were to make pilgrimages to Jerusalem to sacrifice, and this was the big one. And in the courtyards of the temple were cellars of animals, of sheep, of cattle, of doves. And it depended how wealthy you were, what you could afford. But you had to buy their animals. But also to buy their animals, you had to get special tax money, temple money. And the money changers were there because people were coming in from all around the Mediterranean world with different sorts of currencies. And so the money changers changed their money into temple money so they could buy the animals that they could sacrifice. It had become corrupt. They were ripping people off. So Jesus took a whip, made a whip of cords, and drove out all the animal sellers. Then he turned the tables of the money changers and all the coins. I just felt like going back to the basket there and just turning it over. All the quarters went everywhere. Corruption. The injustice cried out. And he had to do something. But why did Jesus get angry? The disciples, looking back on this event, saw something in the Old Testament that Jesus was doing. It's from Psalm 69, verse 9. And it says, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Jesus had a passion for his Father's house, for the temple in Jerusalem. And zeal is a strong word. It overcomes. It drives people. We also heard today the Ten Commandments twice. One of those commandments was, "Thou shalt not steal." I'm sure Jesus had that in mind. These guys were stealing, robbing from them. Also, he probably had in mind that within the house of God in the temple, you were to worship God. I would suggest that these guys worshiped money. So there was an injustice calling out to Jesus. And then the Jews asked Jesus, "What sign can you give us as to why you're doing this?" The Jews were always looking for a sign from God to make sure that what was happening was the right thing. And Jesus gave them a strange answer, like a cryptic puzzle. Destroy this building in 3 days, and I will raise it up again. Sorry, destroy this building, and I will raise it up in 3 days. It had taken Herod and all his crowd 46 years to rebuild the temple, as Jesus saw it in his day. But Jesus said, destroy this building, and I will raise it again in 3 days. He wasn't talking about the building made of stone, the temple in front of him. He was talking about himself. Because the temple that the Jews worshipped at was only a shadow. It was only a foretaste of the true temple that was to come. The true temple was Jesus himself. Corruption was in his father's house, and injustice cried out, and he had to act. When I thought about this, I couldn't help but think about God's love. You might think, how do you get God's love out of Jesus being angry, frustrated, indignant at what was happening? But when I thought about it, I really thought about John 3:16. Because God looked at us, and God looks at us, and he sees corruption inside us. Some of it is our own fault, but some of it is the systems that we live in. Some of it is the evil that is in the world. And that injustice cried out, and he had to do something about it. God so loved the world that he sent his only son. He sent Jesus to deal with the corruption in our lives. And what really struck me was when the Jews went to the temple, they had to buy a lamb. When God sent Jesus, he sent the Lamb of God. And this lamb cost us nothing. The lamb is free to us. And he is the one that died for our sins. He is the one that has taken away the sins of the world. So what about you and me? Do we ever see injustice in our worlds? Do you ever get zealous about something that needs to be driven out? St. John's and Johnstown are big on food injustice. There is an injustice. We also have been helping out with the food pantry in Our Lady of Fatima. What about racism? What about poverty? Trafficking? Bullying? Addiction? What tables need to be turned? What tables do we need to turn? Because if God has done it for us, he wants us to have his eyes to see injustice and do something about it. But what also needs to be turned over in our lives, because this is Lent, and what needs to be driven out from our place inside us? You know what sins you've committed. You know when you read through the Ten Commandments, which one? Yes, I heard it twice this morning. Which ones need driven out? Because when Jesus saw injustice, it cried out, and he had to act. What do we need to do? What do we need to act on? I don't know why the student got angry that day at the school, but something really got to him, and he had to act. We have a good idea of why Jesus did what he did in the temple that day. because it was corrupt, rotten through and through. The place where God's holy presence was, his holy name was revered, had become corrupt. And so he overturned the tables and drove them out. Today is also our healing service. And at the end of our service, we will have a time of prayer. If you need to drive something out, if you need help, or if you need to pray for someone else, or if you are really upset about something, that this is not going to go away, that you keep getting bugged about this, maybe it's God saying to you, look at that injustice. See what you can do about it. So come for healing, come for help, come for guidance, and let God turn the tables. Amen. We are going to affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed, and you will find it on page 2 of our worship bulletin. We stand to say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The prayers of the people.
Prayers of the people are found today of Form 4 on page 388 in the Book of Common Prayer. Your response will be, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We pray for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, presiding bishop, Bishop Jeremiah, Father Alistair and Mother Lori, and Deacon Debbie, and the standing committee. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and all of the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. We pray for Joseph, our president, and Kathy, our governor. Lord, in your mercy, give us all reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all lives who are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. We pray for those who choose to serve in the armed forces, police, and fire departments, especially Andrew, Ben, Chris, Jake, Jesse, John Michael, Josh, Justin, Kyle, Lindsay, Miko, Morgan, Moses, Tim, Will, and Zach. Are there others? We pray for those expecting babies, especially Angela. We pray for the people of Ukraine, Israel, and Gaza. We pray for more homes to meet the needs of foster children. We ask for your blessings on the AA meetings held in our parish hall and elsewhere. We celebrate all the birthdays and anniversaries this week, especially Jennifer and Franklin. Are there others? Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation, especially those on our prayer list. Alicia, Alan, Amanda, Ashley, Bart, Brenda, Camille, Cheryl, Chris and Denny, Christy, Cindy, Cole, Colleen, Debbie and Caleb, Doug, Ed, Fatten, Frank and Peg, Gloria, Helen Marie and John, Jaden, Jeff, Jody, Judy, Judy, Kathy, Keith, Kim, Kyle, Liam, Linda, Lisa, Marcia, Marge, Maria, Marky, Mary, Max, Mickey, Midge, Miko, Neil, Paul, Sharon, and Tristan. Are there others? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation, especially any on our prayer list. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And to share one another's sign of that peace.
Well, I'd like to give you an update on Quarter Dash here, who is helping the children and raise money for the historic restoration of Christ Church. And thank you for your help on bringing in the quarters. He has now gone 27 and a half feet, but I think he's taken a break because we can't seem to find him. Thank goodness I have another. And he has gathered 360 quarters to the tune of $85. So thank you all very much. And after you have your craft with Christina today. The kids are going to come back over, and it looks like they got a lot of quarters to line up. So thank you all very much. The kids are just really having a good time with this. So thank you. And let's see. And on, March 17th, during coffee hour, we're going to be helping Karen with Easter cards to send out to the congregation. So, and I think that's all that I have.
Easter is rapidly coming upon us, and you may see an envelope in your pew for Easter plants. If you'd like to give a contribution in memory of someone, that's how you do it, filling in that, and we will put it into the plate as it goes past. So you have a couple more Sundays if you want to do that. Is there a choir practice this week?
Yeah. Okay. Tuesday night at 7.
Tuesday
night.
So
we are going every Tuesday until Easter.
Okay, so every Tuesday until Easter. Looking forward to hearing the choir on Easter Sunday. Mm-hmm. And we may be doing something different on the first Sunday after Easter. And Kathleen, I'm mentioning you a lot this morning. Kathleen has mentioned to me a couple of times about having a Easter celebration lessons and hymns. We usually have lessons and carols at Christmas. So we're going that Sunday morning to be singing hymns and hearing some of the scripture readings that are associated with the Easter story, and then we will go straight into communion. So that is the Sunday after Easter. So I'm giving you an announcement after Easter, but it's just to whet your appetite for coming that Sunday. Also after Easter, I was thinking, because Mother Laurie and I will possibly be away in September and October on sabbatical, that I'm thinking of running Church 101 class after Easter. So if you're interested in a 6-week introduction to church, the Episcopal Church, and why do we use a prayer book? Why do we do what we do in the Episcopal service? How is the Episcopal Church governed? Where does it fit in with all of the rest of the denominations? This is your opportunity. Quite a few of you have been through the course, and it's been beneficial. Deacon Debbie and I have found it beneficial as well, because when we lead it, we learn more as well. But it's an opportunity for those who haven't yet delved into what church is about, why we do things, how we do things. This is a 6-week course. It'll probably be on a Tuesday evening before choir practice. Oh, no, you have no choir practice after Easter. Yep. And it can be done hybrid, so if you're not able to be in person, you can join us by Zoom. So that is just another announcement for you to take in. Are there any other announcements? Cindy? So that's the rummage sale on the last weekend in April.
Yes.
And I think I might be here.
I was going to say, you're going to be here next year.
Yeah. Anyway. I'll try. Okay. If that is all our announcements, an offertory sentence. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Our offertory hymn is hymn 305 in the green hymnal. Oh, it's three. Sorry.
In the green hymnal?
In the green glass.
Number 3 in the green hymnal.
There we go. Thank you.
Holy, 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 merciful.
your worship bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law. In the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us, by his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets and apostles and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. Seated, continue to stand or kneel. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by Jesus and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection. We await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only, not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal, that the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, and please join me, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, your Church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy upon us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy upon us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Post-communion prayer is on page 4 of our worship bulletin. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work that you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.